BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. So, yesterday we were talking about Ted Bundy, and we're going to be continuing those discussions, but first and foremost, I would like to give a big shout-out to YouTube user Joy Bradford, because we were talking about this in the comments section, and she mentioned the book The Stranger Beside Me by Anne Rule. That was something that I had quoted in the first upload, and I'll post a link to the first upload in the description box or in the comments section below, perhaps. But she was asking me if I had read it, and I said, no, I haven't read that book yet, but that's, of course, one of the things that is very informative and kind of a window into the life of Ted Bundy, who was perhaps one of the, I mean, he is one of the most famous serial killers in American history, if not the famous, as I said yesterday, perhaps in the top five most famous serial killers in American history that people would think about. So, I decided to look on YouTube just to see if perhaps maybe there was a presentation about it, or sometimes they upload the audiobooks to things on YouTube that you can listen to, and sometimes you just can't wait. I mean, you can't even make the trip to the library. I always quote this one friend I had in high school when we were watching a preview for the movie Napoleon Dynamite, and he was like, I want to see that movie, like, right now. I mean, I don't want to go to the theater. I want to watch that, like, right now. You know, if you could just turn it on, you would immediately watch it. That's how I felt about the book The Stranger Beside Me. And I didn't find the audiobook online, but what I found was the 2003 film The Stranger Beside Me, based on the book by Anne Rule, and I decided to check that one out last night. Now, this is a channel where we talk about a lot of true crime events, and while movies like that are dramatic recreations, dramatizations, if you will, we also talked about the film Ted Bundy from 2002 on this channel, and I like to cross-reference these movies that people are putting out about these real-life true crime individuals. I think there is a certain value into it. I know that they're dramatizations, and they take a certain sense of creative liberty sometimes, but in all reality, I get quite curious about how the filmmakers choose to present these individuals, such as the serial killers, or anyone else involved with a high-profile true crime event. And another thing that I also found online was Murderous Minds did a documentary about Ted Bundy, and I cannot recommend that channel enough. It's actually on the Top 5's channel, but they have a series called Murderous Minds, and if you're just someone who is just wanting the facts and information, and you just want to get to the heart of the issue, like only with the facts and information, that's really the stuff. I cannot recommend those things enough. The Murderous Minds documentaries, we did a response to one of theirs on Jeffrey Dahmer, and they just have so much info in a 55-minute documentary film. It's like, this is just so much better than a lot of the studio-generated content out there. But I will tell you, after talking about these things online, sometimes you do want to come at things from a different perspective. And it's not like I'm going to be sharing the most eye-opening things about Ted Bundy in the world. One of the things about more famous true crime individuals is there are countless resources online. But still, here on Black Box Online Radio, we're going to explore a little bit. And if I sort of say anything that maybe someone would disagree with, I would love for that person to challenge that point. Leave a comment below, and let's have a bit of a discussion about all this. So without further ado, let's continue our discussion on Ted Bundy, somebody who confessed to 30 murders, all women, all roughly of the same age group, all resembling his ex-girlfriend, Stephanie Brooks. He is definitely somebody who had an axe to grind with women, for so to speak. And I don't mean that to be weird. I mean that is because you could call it sort of a vendetta, but really it's the response to being rejected. And apparently by his own admission, the thing that he really feared was humiliation. And I was reading a forum about narcissism several years ago, and somebody was writing that narcissists use, well, their narcissism as a way to mask their feelings and their fears of rejection and humiliation. That's why this narcissistic personality takes place. They're trying to cover up their fear of humiliation and rejection. They have a very large ego, very high self-esteem, but it's fragile, and it can be fractured very easily. And it was actually a very fascinating discussion to read because on some psychology forum years ago, because somebody was countering by saying that narcissists do not have high self-esteem. They have extremely low self-esteem, and that's why they become narcissists. And someone saying, no, narcissists have a very high view of themselves, so high that it is a clinical disorder, pretty much. And one of the things that was mentioned very clearly by the Murderous Minds documentary, available here on YouTube, is that Ted Bundy was indeed a sociopath. I think all people are in agreement about that. But all sociopaths and psychopaths are narcissists, but not all narcissists are sociopaths and psychopaths. It's like, so he was a sociopath, he was a narcissist, he was someone who didn't really experience empathy and sympathy for other people. He kind of used people for his own gratification. And as we mentioned in part one, knowing that there would be somebody out there that would have feelings for the victim and would be missing the victim and caring about their daughter would only fuel his excitement, to quote the doctor, Park Dietst. Now, when I was watching the film, The Stranger Beside Me, it was kind of hard to describe. Like, if I were to sit down and talk to somebody about that film, I would say it was not a biography. And I'm sure the book is really going to explore the relationship between Anne Rule, someone who worked with Ted Bundy at a crisis center, and the serial killer herself, Anne Rule and Ted Bundy's relationship. But the film, I thought, was more about the legal aspects of the case, not the psychology, not like even personal anecdotes, although there were a few. It was really about how does Ted Bundy confront the challenges of the law, and how does law enforcement go after Ted Bundy? What are they doing with the profiling process? And a very interesting thing was made in that comment. Like, a very interesting comment was made in the film, that Ted Bundy chose to defend himself in his trial. Once again, up against countless murders. We don't even necessarily know how many people he murdered, but confessing to many of them. But he's when he's going up against the death penalty, he chooses to defend himself. And they're saying, that's all about control. That's just another act of control. It's almost just like he's trying to play God. He's trying to place himself at the top of the dominance hierarchy. And if that's not a fear of humiliation and rejection from other people, especially rejection, I don't know what else is. I mean, there has to be some sort of connection there. I don't believe there could be anything to the contrary about that, that he's just always trying to force himself to the top of these dominance hierarchies because of a lot of bad childhood experiences that he had, and what we called yesterday about the shattering of the pillars of childhood, learning that his mother had been lying to him about his real ancestry his whole life, lying to him about his father, and his father's actually listed as unknown on the birth certificate, although most people believe that they know the identity of his father, that he was a sailor. But it's like, that definitely has to be very traumatic for somebody to experience. Now, one of the other things that I would insist upon is, I noticed a lot of similarities between Ted Bundy and an individual named Daniel Marsh. I mentioned this yesterday. But one of the things I heard from Murderous Minds was that I haven't really heard in other Ted Bundy documentaries, as well as and YouTube videos and the news clips and, once again, the feature films that they put out about Ted Bundy, is that he became very involved with pornography in his early 20s, like really took a fascination with violent pornography. And I saw that exactly in Daniel Marsh. Someone who has a documentary out there, there's a documentary out about Daniel Marsh called Portrait of a Killer. It's actually an episode of CBS 48 Hours, but that's what it's called, Portrait of a Killer. And that's how Daniel Marsh responded to the shattering of the pillars of childhood being betrayed by his mother. He went to gore porn, specifically. Ted Bundy apparently went to violent pornography in his late 20s. And there seems to be some sort of pattern that we're noticing. When people go through bad experiences and they turn to stimuli is the plural of stimulus, right? Okay, so when they go to these things to stimulate themselves, they are trying to push the boundaries, to get something more and more extreme to take away the negative feelings that they're having in their lives. And when they go to pornography, they gotta just watch something more and more intense. And that gets to the point where they need to start acting out the things that become attractive to them. And for Ted Bundy, it was just absolutely focusing in on domination, even to the point where he wants to have sex with dead women because he can completely dominate them. And One of the things they mentioned in the Ted Bundy film from 2002 was he was telling his girlfriend that he wants her to pretend like she's dead while she's tied up in bed and they're having sex. And he obviously wanted the partner in a state where he could dominate them. And sexuality, aggression, and dominations, we call the trinity of true crime sexuality. I mean, like, it's just like, that's what happens. The trinity of true crime sexual deviance, perhaps that's a better name for it. But with Ted Bundy, absolutely an antisocial personality, deviant behavior off the charts, not only is he developing weird fantasies as a result of pornography, I mean, it's not only that he's having sick fantasies, he's also very much involved with shoplifting, he's a peeping Tom, and the film, the 2002 film, begins with him masturbating in an alley, and somebody, like, throws water on him, because, like, oh, you again? I don't like to give away movie endings, but I think you can guess how the film Ted Bundy would end. I think you can take a guess. But it's just like all kinds of antisocial behavior. And with pornography, it's the same thing. With antisocial behavior, it's the same thing. They are pushing the boundaries to get a more and more extreme response. To get a larger extreme stimulation. And I think a lot of the psychologists that have been featured in the documentaries talking about Ted Bundy say various things, and across all of the serial killer spectrum, they're talking about that. This person is just using people for their own gratification, but it comes to the point where killing people is not enough. So what they need to do is they need to push the boundaries to a larger extreme to get a stronger feeling and a stronger stimulation. And with somebody like Ted Bundy, it really does seem very apparent. It seems like he was involved with a lot of deviant behavior, but he learned how to mask it. And he learned that by dressing a certain way, by acting a certain way, and by behaving in a certain way, that he could hide this from people, and that he could be very charming, he could be charismatic, he could be involved in a variety of different things that would make people not suspect him, whether it's local and state politics, whether it's being a good student in law school. Although they did say, though, in some of his during some time in his collegiate career, he really did slump. I believe that was actually when he was studying psychology, of all things. Psychology is not an easy thing. I mean, I took Psych 101 twice. The first time I had to withdraw because I was failing. The second time I passed with a D. Damn it. It's some people respond to different school subjects in different ways, but I digress from that. So you see, though, that these ways that Ted Bundy is kind of building this facade is not arbitrary. We mentioned yesterday that was something that they were talking about on the Biography Channel documentary about Ted Bundy, that he learned from a very early age that there are different social classes, that there are different kind of intellectual classes, and he definitely had a fascination with this sort of more advanced form of, or just like upper-level intellectual classes. Like, he had this because he was being from exposure from his uncle, and you can just sort of see that these people are more educated than other people, and, oh, well, if I start acting like this and acting like them, maybe I can climb up in the social hierarchies or just make himself more presentable to other people. One of the things, though, that really does surprise me about Ted Bundy is, even before all that, in high school, girls still thought he was very attractive, and apparently he only went to the dance when they did the turnaround dance where the girls asked the guys, because, like, apparently he just didn't show much of an interest in dating back when he was in high school, and that could also be stem from antisocial behavior. Absolutely, it could. Remember, antisocial just means against the social norm, and he probably was somewhat of a very awkward person in his teen years, from what the descriptions say. But we were going to be looking at some other things about Ted Bundy. I think it's very important to note that his childhood wasn't only shattered about this revelation that he was actually thinking the person that he knew as his sister turned out to be his biological mother. That's not everything. And one of the things that they do mention in The Stranger Beside Me is that his grandfather raped his grandmother, and I mean, apparently he was very much aware of that, in that had sort of affected him in some ways as well. Apparently his grandfather was somewhat of an abusive personality, And that affected his state of mind as well. But when they say the term sociopath to describe Ted Bundy, this is different than the psychopath, meaning the psychopath is born that way. The sociopath develops these tendencies over time, like because of like sociopath, like social, sociopath, like society. And you can really see that the personality of Ted Bundy was, I believe anyway, in my own uneducated opinion. Once again, I got a D in psychology, but it seems like there were things in his social surroundings that did shape his personality in this particular way and drove him to have these types of murderous impulses. And I don't believe that there's one single event that just caused him to snap. I mean, we often try to look for that. There could possibly be a large event that greatly affected him more than other things. But what it really seems like is that there are just everything went wrong. And that's what I believe about all of these high-profile serial killers, whether it's Jeffrey Dahmer or John Wayne Gacy or H.H. Holmes. Everything went wrong. It's like all of these bad things are coming together at once. You might have cases like Paris Bennett, who is perhaps a more clinical psychopath who could have genuinely just been born that way and born into those types of feelings. I mean, so I believe anyway. But a big thing to say about that is, by the way, right now I would just like to say, if anyone would like to challenge any of the points that we've made in this, please feel free to do so once again. When sometimes people correct me on this channel, and I'm like, all right, I have to accept your correction. Always open to correction. Because first and foremost, I just want to know about this stuff because it improves our understanding of human life, right? But a lot of times, people will just be like, everything you said is wrong. Well, okay, well, which parts? Well, why don't we talk about it? Even for the sole fact that you're just trying to set me straight. But a lot of times, people are like, just everything you said about this guy is wrong. And, well, how are we going to improve if we don't exactly know where is wrong, what is wrong? What are the exact specific things that you would like to dispute? If you would like to dispute a certain fact, or if you would like to share something and contribute to the conversations, hey, bring it on. Those things are more than welcome. But even if you don't care about anything that I'm saying, what about the other people who could be checking something out in the comments section? And if you have something genuine to share about these things, we want to hear it. Because one of the things that I do have to admit when starting a YouTube channel like this one was, I never anticipated how many friends and family members of the people we talk about would have actually reached out to the show and contacted me, or just, even if they're just leaving comments in the comments section below. I mean, that has happened more times than I can count. And they're like, they have an insider perspective. But then when I just sort of ask, you know, for a few more details or to discuss a little bit more, like, well, what do you have to say about it? Those things often go unanswered. And not only talking about the people with first-hand sources, but, like, anybody. If you have something to share, I would love to hear from what you have to say. And Ted Bundy is a big case, because he really modeled a lot of the psychology and the way that people are approaching serial killers over the last, I guess now you would say, 45 years. But it's like, this is also a case where I believe the term serial killer was actually first applied to Ted Bundy. That was like the concluding card that they put up at the end of the 2002 film Ted Bundy. I mean, if that is true, that he was the first person in America to be referred to as a serial killer, and the term came about because of him, I could see that. But it's like, I would just have to say, though, that the psychology behind somebody like Ted Bundy is not isolated. Absolutely not. We already mentioned the similarities of somebody like Daniel Marsh, who was involved with a double murder. We should be very clear that Daniel Marsh was not somebody who murdered 30 people. But the other person that I really saw similarities with was Paul Bernardo. And Paul Bernardo was the Scarborough Rapist of Canada who studied American Psycho, the novel, like it was his Bible. An interesting thing, though, that I heard about Ted Bundy in the Murderous Minds documentary was that one of the things that attracted his longtime girlfriend to him was that he talked with something that sounded somewhat like a British accent. And it wasn't, like, not quite a British accent, but almost. And I mentioned on the channel once before that there's the film Vampire's Kiss, which is, I believe it was filmed in 1988. It's with Nicolas Cage. There's a very famous scene where he's running down the street shouting, "I'm a vampire! I'm a vampire! I'm a vampire!" But what stands out to me about that one is it's kind of like a more contemporary version of American Psycho. You're actually dealing with some guy in the 1980s that is going crazy, and it's all set, you know, and filmed in the 80s, whereas American Psycho was filmed about 10 years after that, and they're just trying to replicate it. But the character that Nicolas Cage was playing in that film, I believe his name was Peter Lowe, and I first thought, oh, is he supposed to be playing a British guy? But then I listened more closely, and I was like, oh no, he's American, but he's just kind of talking in a British way. And I don't know, I mean, I don't even know if there's any sort of relevance to Ted Bundy or connection with that. I just thought that they both said kind of the same thing, that Ted Bundy would kind of talk with almost a very slight British accent for a while. And as we mentioned, though, he's some guy who learned, like, oh, what are people doing to sound like they're in certain cultural classes and such. And he was someone who probably had a great sense of social awareness. And absolutely, if you just look at his work with local and state politics and his ability to just manipulate people and deceive the police for as long as he did, he was very aware of that stuff. And I think there is a certain sense of apathy involved with that. Like, people who are apathetic to a system learn how to manipulate it. We first talked about that on our episode involving Leopold and Loeb. Like, you know, like Leopold and Loeb were two killers, right, who thought that they were just so smart and so much more intelligent than other people that they could create the perfect crime, right? I mean, that one's a fairly famous case. I don't think we need too much more explanation than that. And with Ted Bundy, you could also see a certain sense of similarity in that. Whereas, and I think that stems purely from his psychopathic tendencies, being apathetic to the emotions of other people, being apathetic to human empathy, being apathetic to the law, which apparently he was studying and trying to become a lawyer. You see this sense of apathy. And he was probably somebody who was, like, being apathetic to the system, so he learned how to manipulate it. And that's how he continued to do these things as long as he did. Well, I think we're going to have to leave it there for now. Once again, I would love to discuss this case with you a little bit more. And it's not like I'm going to be giving the most perfect description of Ted Bundy in the world. So feel free to leave any comments below. If you like this upload, you can hit the like button. If you haven't subscribed already, you're welcome to subscribe. And let's talk a little bit more about Ted Bundy or any of the other true crime cases that we mentioned on this channel. And until next time.